for his role in electoral reforms, right to information, and administrative reforms. He's also the founder and general secretary of the public policy think tank Foundation for Democratic Reforms, located in Hyderabad. He has been the member of Legislative Assembly in Andhra Pradesh, and above all, he's a political reformer, a public intellectual whom all of us look up to, and a personal role model. Sir, if I could please request you to enlighten us with your thoughts.
Okay, let's start off. How many of you have gone to a government office in recent months or years for a personal outcome? Good. Start off. Tell me briefly, tell me which office, for what purpose, what happened? Driving license.
It was very long queues, the place was dirty.
So it happened routinely.
Yeah, but it got done. Yeah, it
was okay. Driving license is one of the things where things have improved, though fellows who can't drive are getting licenses, that's a problem. But otherwise, in terms of the rest of governance, I'm an optimist. I believe actually corruption has come down, things have actually improved. So other than driving license, with this caveat. Now, anybody? Yes?
Sir, I lost my cell phone. It was stolen. So
you
I
lost
went
to your cell phone?
Yeah.
You so went to a police station to complain?
Right. So, and I learned something. So now there's an online form for reporting anything that's any personal article. So the local station told me to just download that form and just submit it to them. So I don't even have to come. I can just give it to somebody. And that's a pre-signed form. So it saves a lot of...
So technology has improved the service in some respects.
Yeah, so I went to the Jan Seva Kendra I'm basically from Gujarat. So I went to register myself for the election card.
Okay.
And I realized that... there were not many people actually on their post. So when I went to inquire about the procedure to fill up the form to apply for the election card, there was a person who said, you go to this manager. And then when I went there.
Where was this?
In Surat.
In Surat?
Yeah.
Okay.
So he said that the person is not here, you come after 2 days. Then when I went there 2 days later, he said that you go to the senior manager and speak. But when I went there, he said
this is in the
no,
municipal corporation.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then he said that no, this officer is on leave, so you go to him. And then when I went to him, he said that we don't deal with this kind of stuff. So basically, it was a very bad experience for me for registering for the voter ID.
Okay. So we have a driving license experience. A cell phone lost the complaint, and we have voter registration. Anybody else?
So I filed an RTI for a research that I was doing on Municipal Corporation of Delhi. So first I filed it at the Home Ministry because earlier the MCD was...
What kind of information you sought?
So the Municipal Corporation was trifurcated, so there were committee reports that... 3-4 committees
okay.
had come, so they weren't public online.
So what happened? Did they give you information?
No, so they told that we've transferred them now to the Delhi government. When I sought the Delhi government.
Where is this?
Sorry, this was Home Ministry, the Central Home Ministry.
You asked for information from where?
From the Ministry of Home Affairs.
Oh, I see, okay.
Because they
You don't count in our discussion now, because I'm talking about a personal...
Yeah.
A personal need.
Okay.
Something that you needed as a person, as a citizen.
Okay.
Yes. I'll come to you.
Sir, recently in my family, we transferred land from one party to another party.
Okay.
So we had gone to Tehsildar office in Maharashtra. So that time, when we were doing the whole procedure, we signed so many documents. Both the parties signed the documents. But that person, class 2 officer, he asked so many questions, and after that he had to enter the whole data into the software. But by mistake he pressed some button and the process was stopped for some point of time. We waited for 3 hours, and after that somehow he spoke to the people and the managed the whole thing. So we spent the 2 days in that procedure.
Was a bribe asked?
Sorry?
Was a bribe asked? Bribe?
No.
There was no corruption. I'm quite impressed. You only had some inconvenience because of technological lag.
Yes,
but I'm actually quite impressed that there was no bribe sought for a property transfer. which makes it to me pretty impressive. Okay.
These days, getting a passport is easier than getting a driving license. In case you have all the documents ready, you just apply, and within the third day, you get the passport delivered at your doorstep without any police verification. The police verification happens after you receive the passport. That was a very wonderful experience I had.
So you had a good experience.
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
Hello. So, sir, we bought a house last year.
Okay.
So
please raise your hand. Okay.
We bought a house last year. So the ADM Finance filed a case against the registry, that the registry has been registered below the circle rate, for example, circle rate price is X. So we have registered less than X.
Where was this?
So, sir, this was in Ghaziabad.
Okay.
So we went to that Ghaziabad registry wali place, I don't know what we call it, civil court I guess. So we went there, so that was a very worst experience because they called us for around 11-12 times and the case hasn't been resolved as of now. And they are asking for some bribes.
Okay. But the last sentence?
They are indirectly asking for bribes. They were like, SNE hoga kaam, you have to pay something.
So finally what happened? So it's still pending.
Yes.
You are trying to figure out whether or not to pay a bribe, and if so, how much? And to whom?
Okay, I'll get it back to you.
Okay. All right.
I applied for a passport in like 2014. Me and my twin sister, I have a twin sister. So she got her passport. She's studying in Ukraine right now. And in 2016, like in this semester break, finally I got my passport. Huh?
It took 2 years?
Yeah, because they had some doubt on my birth certificate. Finally, this got resolved when I study in Maharashtra. So whenever I come to Delhi for my semester breaks, every time I had to go to Akepuram, that regional passport office. And then finally, this time they said, we have already issued you a passport. I said, no, that hasn't been happened. So they were like, no, there is this passport. So I was like, no, this is my twin sister's file. So they said, you have to submit an affidavit declaring that you have a twin sister. I said, why? They said, apparently your particulars are same, your parents are same, your school is same and all that. So I was like, me and my twin sister have a same date of birth, except for that, even siblings have the same information. So they were like, it's your job, you have to do it if you want a passport. So finally I had to give an affidavit and then I got my passport.
You got a passport. Okay. All right. Yes.
I have bought one house in Hyderabad. I went for the registration in register office. So all the documents we have produced, and when it went to the register table, they said that the survey number is in some GO, so it should not get registered. So we have to get the clearance certificate from the municipality. Okay, no objection certificate we have to get somewhere.
Oh, okay.
Actually speaking, they don't know where to get even.
Okay.
So when we came back and said that the broker who is getting it registered, if you give us 10,000 rupees, it can be done in half an hour. Without certificate also, they are ready to do the registration.
As long as you are willing to pay.
Yes.
How much did they demand?
10,000 rupees they asked.
10,000 rupees. Okay.
Our license office. So I had a person accompanying me to get the license made.
Driving license again, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I saw that beside the driving license office, there were these multiple photocopy shops. So the people in these, the person who was accompanying me told me that aapka license jaldi ban jayega. You just pay 3,000 rupees to these people. They'll put some sign on your papers. They'll tell you what the questions they are going to ask inside.
Where was this?
This was behind Vidhan Sabha Metro Station.
In Delhi.
The license in Delhi.
Others who had good experience with driving license, where was that? So in the same city, you now have different models. Okay.
So, all right. You could get it done the normal way as well, although it would take a lot of time, but if you would have that signature, that sign in your papers, you would get it done very quickly and your passport, your driving license is guaranteed. So, this was one way that people suggested.
Okay. Yes. The last one for the time being.
Actually, it was a good experience. It was post office in Mumbai. Navi Mumbai.
Post office, there was no problem. What did you need the post office?
Actually, I had missed something was to be delivered. There were some urgent, important documents, and I missed that because I was not at home. So I had to go back and get it there. So,
but there was no problem. You were happy with the service.
Yeah.
Okay. Look at these services. Is there any one of them where Narendra Modi can make a difference? Or Rahul Gandhi, if you like Rahul Gandhi? Or anybody else for that matter? These are the illustrations that you gave, right? I have not given. These are things that you needed in your daily life. Is there one of them which actually could be improved by a prime minister in this country? By a government of India? How? Which one?
Passport service?
Yeah, in the sense that they can...
They can, yeah.
If there are any deficiencies in the system, they can set it right. But trust me, there was a time in Hyderabad where the demand was for an excess of supply. And because for a passport you have to pay a fee, there is enough resource available. And all they required was a franking machine from Germany. Only Germans make that machine. You know the franking? You don't have an Indian machine, and obviously you can't take chances with that. A passport is a very important secure document, right? And because of centralization, because of government of India, despite money being available, demand being there, people willing to pay the service fee as passport fee, and all they required is franking machine. It took them 1.5 years to get it. So government of India made things worse, not better. This is a real life example. In Hyderabad passport office, asked them 4 years ago what happened, 5 years ago. So if actually Modi has to do it, or government of India has to do it, it will get worse, not better. A fair case? Anybody else?
So post office, because telecommunications are under central government?
Yes, if you notice, I put some on the left, some on the right, I put post office in the middle. You know why? It is about the only service in India which the government provides, which is almost like going to a shop. For whatever reasons, the way the postal department, its service delivery is structured right from the beginning, well before independence, is like going to a shop and getting you pay and get things done. It's the only office where before going to the office, you enter without any trepidation. There's no fear, there's no anxiety. You know, will the fellow do it or not? Will he be available? Will he take my petition? Will he actually do it? Do I have to pay a bribe? If so, to whom and how and how much? If you don't want to pay a bribe, what will happen to me? How many times do I have to come back? Do I have to make somebody make a phone call? And if so, who? What is that fellow's caste? You know, subconsciously, a lot of these things go on in our minds, right? When really the government office. But post office is about the only agency in the country where things happen as a matter of routine. Without much of computerization, even in the old-fashioned branch post offices in the villages without computerization, to the most sophisticated modern central post offices, etc., you have a culture. So a post office is a separate thing. It is owned by government of India, but in fact, in many ways, it's an example. How to improve delivery in government, post office could be an important example. What are the things we have done right in post offices? What are the things we are doing wrong elsewhere? Why is post office behaving different? That's why I put there at the center. It's a slightly different case. You take driving license, while there are some problems, it is amenable to technological innovation, computerization, and therefore you can increasingly improve it. Even if it's a centralized service, doesn't matter for the time being at least. Cell phone lost again, well, it's the same problem you had in terms of an offense committed in the house. Somebody came and attacked you, or there's some other dispute where there's a crime committed, you'd have had different experience. But because it's a cell phone thing, a high-tech issue, they probably created a separate cybercrime wing or something, and they dealt with it in a slightly different manner. A separate eco-culture is evolved. Otherwise, if you go to a police station for a complaint about a normal crime, you would have understood much of Indian governance. So technology again has come to aid. Passport again. But even passport is explained to you, this is a real life case, because the franking machine was not available, though money was available. And somebody had to give a chapa and clear it and then buy it and give it to you. For 2 years, the backlog was considerable. All this gives us two broad conclusions. One, the central government, or even state government in many cases, in respect of our own lives and our daily needs as human beings is inconsequential in a large measure. I'm not saying entirely, but I'm saying what they do or what they don't do in most cases is of no value to us. It's only for gupshop, for chatting over dinner and talking about the newspaper headlines and, you know, all this Narendra Modi versus this or somebody. It really doesn't make a difference to our lives. Have you realized it? And see how much time you all spend discussing, quote unquote, the central government of India or Narendra Modi. You get it? Anybody has serious reservations on this point? Anybody? Okay, we'll move on. Let me give an example. Even passport, which is a federal service anywhere in the world, in Germany, you don't even have to go to a passport office, which is a federal office. Because first of all, you assume that everybody is in Delhi or in Mumbai or some other place where there's a passport office. What happens to a small little fellow in Jalna or Hoshangabad or some other small town or village? In Germany, I have myself seen it, it doesn't matter where you live, all you do is go to the neighborhood municipality. In whichever municipality you live, you go to the municipal office, you file an application. Now, obviously, service is not provided by the municipality. That's a federal service anywhere in the world. Passports can be a local service. But that's not our problem. They deal with the federal government because it's their problem. 15 days later, you go and collect it from that office, period. Just imagine. What we think is a federal service, high quality service, a lot of computer networking is required. You have to ensure that, you know, like her case, there is no confusion about the passports and the identity of the person who has a passport. It is a very vital document, world over. Particularly in these days of terrorism, illegal migration, all kinds of things. And yet, they are able to provide high quality service with access locally without having to worry. And the synergy is, after all, the local government knows you more than anybody else. In some sense, they could be involved also. But more important for you, there is a point of convergence. You don't see that here. In our country, largely, things are improving. You yourself have indicated, whether driving license or cell phone, lost cell phone, etc. Things definitely are improving thanks to technology. Wherever technology, wherever competition has come in, things are improving. No thanks to real governance improvement, not because of systemic improvement. And because you all come from a certain class background, and because your parents are taking care of your day-to-day household needs, your water supply, your sewerage connection, your electricity connection, fuse call if there is a power shortage or there is a failure of power, garbage disposal, and 20 other things that you deal with at the local level, none of you talked about it because you probably are not exposed. Maybe you heard about them. But these are the real things that matter to people. Even the traffic in front of your house, in your locality, what happens? So the broader question I'm raising is, this notion that central government is central to our lives is a nonsensical notion. Paradoxically, it's the local government that is central to our life. The things that actually matter, not the things that you think matter. Is it a fair point? I made a very provocative observation. I made a very challenging observation. Is it a fair point? Yes or no? You're agreeing because no, you don't want to fight with me, or you broadly think it's a sensible point?
I mean, I understand what you've been saying, but also I think the idea of what then constitutes my daily life is very narrow. I agree that, so if my, you know, all of these services, the local rubbish collection by the municipal department, all of these do constitute a vital part of my daily life. But at the same time, taxes applied to sort of the vegetables I buy, if I'm a smoker, the cigarettes that I smoke, all of these things, they also affect my daily life in a very direct manner.
And what things?
The taxes. This is just one of the most basic examples.
Taxation
applied. Those are very much a part of the central government and the state government as of now, depending on whatever happens.
Okay.
But those also affect my daily life in a very direct manner. So you can't say that the central government is absent then to a very large extent from my daily life.
Okay. I hear you. We'll come back to that. It's a good point. I'm not saying you must do away with central government. I'm not saying Narendra Modi must resign immediately. I'm not asking the liquidation of Indian government. I'm saying in our mind space, in our public discourse, what really matters is relegated to something very, very subordinate, which is not even discussed. What really is a very limited consequence takes up most of our attention, space, and time and energy. Look at your media discourses. Let's say somebody has, do you have chikungunya in Delhi? Dengue fever? Or something else? We always, A, we don't discuss those issues. B, if we do discuss occasionally, entirely for political reasons, because elections are coming, somebody makes it an issue in a particular state, it's taken as a grand national debate. Second one. Do you have any idea, because you raised the issue of taxes, I'm not taking it up in any structured manner, I'm sort of letting it flow. You raised the important question of taxes. Do you have any idea of the share of taxes, if they take the total tax base or the expenditure of the government in this country, how much is spent by the local governments in India? How much by states? How much by union? Okay. How much does government spend at all in this country? At any level, all levels put together. You give me any number, share of GDP, absolute number for a year, daily expenditure, anything. I am quite content with any answer you give. I will try and convert that. In dollars, in rupees, in purchasing power parity, doesn't matter.
I don't know, sir, this is just a layman.
Raise your hand, please.
I'm here, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know, maybe this is a very layman understanding of it, but because of the concept of deficit that exists, I don't know economics at all, but I'm guessing that the government spends more than they receive.
That's okay. There's nothing wrong with that also. As long as money is not spent wisely, you must borrow money. At a certain stage of economic development, the government must borrow money. If you don't borrow money, you are being unwise. Borrowing for what is the issue, not whether borrowing or not. That doesn't matter. I'm talking of numbers. Anybody has an idea of numbers? How much money is government spending?
Somewhere around the, India has been said that it's a $2.04 trillion economy.
Yes.
So somewhere around that particular path, the government aims
that's the
to
GDP, but what about the government's tax collection?
It's around 10% of that. Around 10% of that somewhere.
About 10%, okay. Anybody else?
If my understanding is right, the budget allocation is somewhere around 5.5 lakh crores or something, if my understanding is right.
Okay. You are right about $2 trillion economy, give or take a little bit, a little more than $2 trillion. Tax GDP ratio, what the government at various levels is collecting as taxes, is roughly about 17%, 1/7, give or take a half a percent. I'm not going to be very accurate in decimals, but roughly that number is accurate. We are borrowing at the union and the state levels put together another 9 to 10%. So it becomes a total of about 25, 26 or 27%. That is the government expenditure. 27% of GDP is government expenditure. 17 or 18% is the actual tax revenue. The balance is the borrowing. Does it make sense? Out of the 27%, how much local governments are spending in India? Any idea?
Recently, 14th Finance Commission has recommended 20 lakh crore to the Gram Panchayats over the 2015 to 2020.
Nowhere near that. Nowhere near that. Out of the 39 lakh crores or so that's recommended for transfer to states and local governments, the states are getting only about 7% of the money, 7.5% of the money, 1/14th of that amount, 2,80,000 crores or thereabout. Nowhere near. If this 23 lakh crores, I would have been delighted. That's what I fought for. We are nowhere near that. Okay? All right. The local governments in toto spend around 1% or a little under 1%. If you actually take away Mumbai Municipal Corporation, which is probably the biggest spender. If you take away Delhi, Delhi state government is nothing but local government. Delhi chief minister is the most empowered mayor of a city. You don't call him mayor. That's why people get so excited. If local government is really powerful, would have been there empowered to do things. See the excitement in Delhi. You may or may not like the chief minister and the government, but citizens really get engaged. They get worked up. They get worried. They get involved. It becomes part of political discourse. We simply called it the chief minister and the cabinet. It's basically local government. Nowhere else in the country do you have such empowered mayor or empowered local government. Delhi is the best. Okay? So if you take away Delhi, Mumbai, etc., it will come to probably 0.5% of GDP. Compare this with, let's say, with almost any country. I'll give one example, United States. US spends roughly about 37-38% of the GDP. The numbers keep slightly varying. A little under 40% of GDP in government. India spends less than other countries, by the way. If you take all the rich countries, their expenditure as a share of GDP would be 37, 38, 40, 45. There are some countries which go up to 50%, but most countries are in that range, with the exception of a few rich countries, namely Singapore, Hong Kong, and probably Taiwan. I'm not too certain, but we can verify. Otherwise, generally, the rich countries, the share of GDP that the government spend is in that range, 35 to 45. Take the US. The federal government spends roughly about 14-15%. The local government spend roughly about 14-15%. Your counties, your cities, from New York to a small city, everything they call a city there. The state spend typically about 6-7%. That's why whenever there is any big issue, let's say in the US, from terrorism to a water crisis, who is the first person that comes before you? Before the country? The mayor. When 9/11 happened, the biggest name in the country at that time was who? Gillian. He was the mayor at that time. Even yesterday he was on TV. Because of that experience, they put him before global audiences yesterday. Last night or yesterday, I don't remember, I was watching. So it's the local government that really is in charge of everything. The other governments assist the local government when required. Don't they have other functions? Of course, yes. The state has some functions. The federal government has some functions. But the things that matter to people most of the time are dealt with at the local level. Because they are best dealt with at local level, managerially, in terms of accountability, it is best that they are dealt with at local level. Whether it's a school board, or local health service, or 100 other things that happen, including local fire service, local policing, and 100 other things, they all happen local. Somehow in India, we've gotten into our heads this notion that everything has to be here. And this is something we shouldn't even touch. Whereas this is the only thing that actually delivers to us. I want you to really focus on that. So when you talk of empowerment of local governments, the traditional notion of India is the Gandhian notion. Village republics and, you know, all these 2,000, 3,000 years ago, independent village governments, etc., etc. I don't think we should have romanticism about it. We must look at it much more carefully. Why should we look at local governments? What is the reason why local governments, if they are structured properly, could be more effective than a centralized, bigger government, whether it's state level or national level? Doesn't matter, in the national or state. Look at UP. What is the population of UP? Pardon? 20 crores plus. If it's an independent country, what would be its rank in terms of population in the world? 10 is too low, my friend. Yeah, something roughly like that. after China, India, United States, then Indonesia. In Indonesia, I'm not too sure if they actually crossed 20 crores now. Which is other country really? Russia is about 10, 11 crores, 12 crores, that's all. Soviet Union is different. Pardon? Pakistan, yeah. UP and Pakistan would be competing in terms of population. I agree. Pakistan, because it's a fast growing country. But that's it. So you're looking at fourth or fifth largest country in the world, if it's an independent country. A district in India, how many districts there are in the country? 600 plus. Not every district, but an average, a mid-sized or a reasonable district in India, do you know it's larger than half the countries of the world? True. Look at the atlas, I'm not talking of geographic area, population-wise, and see the populations of the countries, take them in a serial order, and see how many countries have above 3 million population, and how many have below 3 million or 4 million population. Some 30 years ago, or 28 years ago, I heard a district which had at that time 5 million population, a rural district, the largest in my state at that time. In the whole world, there would be only about 55, 60 countries with 5 million plus population. A district in India is larger than half the nations of the world. And a district has probably far greater diversity than almost any other nation outside of India. Just look at the complexity of it. So given that, we should look at local governments not with a romantic eye, but with a pragmatic approach. Why we should localize as much as possible? We have to find rational and balanced arguments. Why? Anybody can come up with an idea? Why should things be local at all? Yes. Understand issues better. Absolutely. Yes?
Geographical area and a bigger population to cater to, so local government can concentrate their efforts into a single area in a much better way.
Now, will you repeat?
I mean, the local government can concentrate their efforts into a smaller area in a much better way, while the federal government has got the control of the huge geographical area and huge population. So the concentration of efforts doesn't happen if everything is centralized.
Okay, local focus is what you're saying. Any other reason? Okay, that means local flexibility. In a diverse country, what you're arguing, I presume, is you can't decide what is good here. Let the people decide locally to suit the local conditions. Is that the argument? Who talked about diversity? You talked about. Is that your argument? Is that your argument? Okay. Yes. Pardon? Okay. Greater accountability.
Feedback is easier.
Pardon?
Feedback is easier with local bodies handling.
Feedback is, yeah. It goes to the accountability. Both these points account. You're absolutely right. Yes?
So, if in any project, it is controlled by the center, then there is a chain of stakeholders in reaching to the grassroots level, and so the corruption increases.
Will you repeat?
So, there will be a chain of stakeholders by which the project will come down to the grassroots level, and that is why the corruption will increase much more if it is the ground level.
Excellent point. Compressing the administrative chain. After all, the strength of a chain is?
What is strong as its weakest point?
Pardon? Weakest link. If you have too many links, one bad link is enough, no matter how wonderful you think you are. If there are fewer links, you know exactly what is weak, and you can probably set it right, and the chances statistically of that going wrong are fewer. Whereas in a long chain, almost certainly there will be weak links, no matter what you do. Very good point. Compressing administrative chain. It's a very good point, this is. Anybody else?
Sir, more and more people are involved in the governance. Thus, it's better and closer to democracy.
Yeah. that point has come. The people know, there will be local accountability. I entirely agree with you. Anybody else? Yes?
Sir, the distortion of information will be much lesser. I mean, as it progresses between levels.
So the feedback will be better. You're absolutely right. Anybody else?
Delivery of public services will be much more efficient and effective.
So, yes.
Oh, sir, even because if it's local, so the people will be more comfortable with their sharing their grievances. So the efficiency will automatically increase. So it'll be better that way.
Great. Anybody else? Yes.
This whole confusion during our elections, right? Is the center responsible, the state responsible? Who do I vote for? Do I vote for one figure? Whose issue is this? My tap is not working, so I will not vote for the central government. All this confusion will reduce to a large extent. You know who you're voting for, you can.
You cannot pass the buck. If you empower somebody, and if you know that that guy or that lady is responsible, nobody has no excuses. Things go well, this guy. Things don't go well, this guy. That clarity brings a lot of efficiency, improves things. You cannot pass the buck. Whereas you ask Narendra Modi, Modi ji, what did he say? Achhe din. And now they're not there. Congress party every day says that. What did Modi say? Honestly? Truthfully. What will he say? Look, bhai, not everything is in my control. I can only do what I can. But the states have to do, local governments have to do, AO. There are real constraints in a large system. If you don't have a mechanism to pass the buck stops here. Then there is a greater likelihood of things improving. Anybody else? Yes?
Better political participation and easier representation.
Better political?
Participation.
Yes. You're absolutely right.
Trust can be increased in the people.
Pardon?
Trust factor. We can improve the trust factor in the people in the governance.
Greater
even the
trust,
monitoring and the evaluation can also be improved.
Political participation. Okay. Anything else?
So one of the most fundamental things which affect people is the policy making. So if policies are made by the very own people who live there and who have seen and actually worked there, then that scenario can change by and far.
The flexibility required is there to suit the local requirements and local conditions. It's not one shoe fitting all. Right, absolutely.
I guess the burden on the central government would come down so that they can concentrate on bringing down better policies in which they are concentrating on.
Union or state, in fact the larger units of government have to focus on what they have to do. And right now, we have only statements of intent and there's no outcome in most cases. You're right. Yes.
So effective change can be brought about altogether across this country instead of the center focusing on it. So the local governments working in their areas form a kind of simultaneous work where everyone's working together in their areas. So it's bringing about a bigger change if we see it collectively instead of seeing it as just one local government.
Good. Somebody raised a hand here.
Effective measurement and easy to replicate and scale. I think the local government has, if the local government has the more power, it will be easy to replicate and
scale.
You can
actually monitor the outcomes much better.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Local resources and solutions. I guess you use local resources and the local.
Absolutely.
The entire insider versus outsider problem of the Rajya Sabha will be solved because when local governments are empowered, I think you will have better representation in the upper house as well. You'll find somebody within your state, somebody essentially from the grassroots level who understands the problem better to represent the interest of the state.
Great. You come up with very powerful arguments, all of you. Let us try and classify these arguments. I don't think I can capture everything, but at least let's have some stuff in a collage of 30, 40 things, some generic principles involved. The first principle that you all come up with is vote and public good are aligned. Because you know that the buck stops there. You know that the vote for X, Y, Z matters. Arvind Kejriwal is elected, he has given the power. If things go well, he deserves credit. Things don't go well, he will be condemned. No confusion. And that's the way it should be. Democracy matures only when that happens. That's why local governments are the best schools for democracy. One of the reasons why we messed up our country is we never allowed anybody to take responsibility. We created a system of alibis, a system of excuses. Everybody in our long chain has excuses for non-performance. You go to, let's say, a collector of a district magistrate who was your friend or your family friend or from your college or something, you say, look, you're a bright guy, you're intelligent, you're honest, you're committed, but nothing much has changed in the district. You go to him with your problem, and by the time you come out of his room after 1 or 2 hours, your shirt sleeves will be wet with his tears. He will have so many complaints. He will talk about so many constraints why he is not able to deliver. You go to a minister, you go to an MLA, MP, chief minister, prime minister, the same story repeats at every level. We have a system of alibis, not a system of performance. If still some things get done, we are lucky. We are so grateful. From there, you have to bring a system of accountability and performance. A system where there are no excuses as far as practicable. And that's the way democracy improves, that's the way vote improves. Taxes and services. If I know where my tax money is going, not some Government of India's budget and Air India's laws and some MP is wasting money or Parliament so much money is wasted every hour. These are all big things I don't know. I must know where my tax money is going and what is happening to it. If I know this is what I have paid and this is what happened, it could happen better. I can relate to it. I can understand it. And it's my life and it's my purse. Nothing is more important than this. Then the choice is also what to do with public money. What is the best way to provide services? What services should you provide? What should you not provide? Which is better if I do it on my own? Which is better if the state local government does it? There will be much greater clarity. And if money is wasted, I feel a very personal thing. Whereas now we all know it's wasted, but it's not anybody's business, except occasionally we shout and we fight. We actually shout, we don't even fight. We don't really care. Whereas if it's your money, your tax money, and the road is not being mended, something else is not happening, you get worked up. Damn it, why am I paying taxes? It's my money. Like a residence welfare association, what do you do in our association? In our own apartments complex. It's our money. We put in every month some maintenance cost, and we actually make sure the services are delivered. That is one form of local organization. May not be a local government in a legal sense, but it is a form of local organization. And certainly it works, right? 90% of the time. If it doesn't work, we have only ourselves to blame because we are the ones who can make a change possible locally. So how much money I am paying? What am I getting? Am I getting the best value for the money? Is the fellow contracting the worst fellow? Is the worker working there as a watchman or something else doing a good job, a bad job? We all are involved. So taxes and services are aligned. Third one, authority and accountability are aligned. I already mentioned to you, there is no alibi. Authority and accountability are aligned. That's the reason why post office works very well. Without decentralization in this sense, it's not a decentralized government, but they have brought in a brilliant principle. They completely aligned authority with accountability. And even in government, if you notice, there are some areas where they work very well. Election time, they work very well, elections. Conduct of elections on the whole, we feel they're doing a good job. Why? The same fellows. The same corrupt, incompetent buffoons conduct elections well. It's not the election commissioners of India who conduct elections. They have nothing to do with that. They're just there. There's a system, there's a process. Because that is where authority and accountability go together completely. No excuses. In local government, it's much more likely that they can be aligned. Fourth one, you brought out this very important point, compressing this administrative chain so that rotten apples are less likely to affect the whole service delivery or make it corruption prone. There's a fifth one I would like to add. You all heard about freebies, the free rice, the free power, loan waiver, a hundred other things. Some of them are justified. Not everything is unjustified, but quite a few of the freebies today are vulgar. We call them vulgar, we oppose them because they only meet the short-term need without improving the quality of life or altering the behavior of people or altering the outcome. So it satisfies you for the time being. The politician in the process has bought the vote with public money, but nothing much has changed. Poverty has not ended and we are unhappy. And if we give something to people which actually changes their behavior, empowers them, increases their earning capacity, and therefore helps them come out of poverty, we are all delighted. We want it to happen. We have to give money to the poor to see that they come out of that morass. But unfortunately, in many cases, politicians and parties, they find it convenient to give something short-term without changing the lives of people, but enough to give the vote for them. A fair statement? Yes or no? We all complain. Look at it from the citizen's point of view. Look at it from a poor fellow's point of view. You go and tell him, give me a lecture. Look, bhai, you are getting free rice. You are getting loan waiver. You borrowed 25,000 rupees. You are getting loan waiver. Hey, sachana shogaya. This is bad for the country. Bharat Mata is weeping. Kya bol rahe hain? In a country where almost nothing happens, I am getting something solid. I borrowed money, I don't have to repay. I take rations, I don't have to pay, it's free. I consume power, I don't have to pay, it's free. What are you telling me? I am benefited. So to go and tell him that, look, this is bad for the country is a nonsensical argument. It's a nice economic argument at a macro level. But for the citizen who is getting a raw deal, all of us feel we are getting a raw deal in the country, right? And imagine a poor person who is eking out a precarious livelihood. They are definitely getting a raw deal. They don't know why or how, but they are getting a raw deal. So all your arguments do not appeal to them. It's very hard. In any country, particularly in a poor country, go to America and try this, it's very hard. In India, incredibly hard. We are a desperately poor country. Supposing, just look at it slightly differently. This argument that you should give up freebies is a bit like saying, you know, your neighbor is a chain smoker. He spends 3,000 rupees a month on cigarettes. You go and give a bhashan to him and say, sir, you should not smoke like this. It's bad for your health. He says, yes. You are spending 3,000 rupees a month. He says, yes. You try to give up smoking. He'll say, let me try. Or I won't give up, whatever is his business. Then you say, you know what to do? You give up smoking and the 3,000 rupees you save, you give me that money. I will decide what should happen to your family with that money. What will he do? He'll slap you and send you home. That's exactly what it is in centralized government. Supposing in the household, the family gets together and says, Papa, you are spending 3,000 rupees on cigarette. It's ruining your health. It's not helping the family. It's ruining our health also. And we're losing money. You stop this. Let's figure out what to do with this 3,000 rupees a month in our family. Now we are talking. There are alternative constituencies talking. Somebody says, look, I want a better school. Somebody says, look, we want a better TV in the house. Somebody says, look, we'll go to a better house. We'll rent out a better house. Somebody says, look, there's no fan here. We'll install a fan. Somebody else says, no, something else is required. There are competing needs for the same resources, but they are benefiting, not some larger amorphous mass. If I am giving this up, I am getting something else locally in my household for my benefit. Then you have an argument. A neighbor coming, or a sarpanch going and telling them, or a municipal chairman going and telling them, don't smoke, give me the money, I'll decide what to do with the smoking money. That's no argument at all. Whereas, let's not waste money like this, let's do something else for our good, which benefits us. Then you're talking. There's a realistic chance that the family will come to a reasonable agreement on what to do with the money. Fair point? So if you want to desubsidize, there is irresponsible subsidies you want to cut down, and if you want public money to be directed more sensibly, the best hope is ultimately local government. What kind of subsidies and how they should be administered? For instance, let's say, in fact, I offered this to a chief minister, very popular and powerful chief minister 30 years ago. I told him, look, you have this subsidized power, etc. At least for my district, you give up that rich subsidized power. But give me back whatever money you are giving to me in the form of subsidized power in another form, and I will do something very tangible and long term, and I'll guarantee that there are no political reactions. Of course, they could not do it because in one geographic area in a larger political entity, it's very hard to make that happen. I made that offer because I had the credibility in that district and my word would be respected, and I knew how to make it happen. So the government thought about it a little bit. They said, finally, yes, it's a good idea, but we can't do it locally in one district. But basically, I tried to embrace the same principle. If what I'm losing in this form of freebies, if I'm getting back in a way that I can see, I can feel, I can benefit from, then the fiscal management will become much more sensible. I'm not guaranteeing that it will work everywhere. There will be populism even locally. There will be some irresponsible fellow saying, no, what is all this? We must do only this way. But there's at least another fellow who is actually getting a benefit and say, look, we must do this way. There is a real fight. It's not a fight between a centralized government and a prime minister or economist and the people. It is actually between various interest groups among the people themselves. Resource management is much, much better. You get it? Any issues up to this point? If you're all agreed on that, then there's nothing more for me to say. We only can have some interaction.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, while I understand that the management will be...
Pardon?
While I understand that management will be something better, don't you think by making these things so isolated, we don't take into consideration that every local government won't be at the same pedestal, and therefore the kind of basic services that you need to provide to citizenry at large won't be provided to them the way they are provided currently when the allocation is taken into consideration by looking at various factors rather than something for the fact that how much you have at your own disposition.
This is a fallacy on account of two reasons. The first is we're assuming that everything will be done by local government. That can never be anybody's case. There are things which are best done at this level. There are things that can't be done at this level. They have to be at this level. There are things which can be done only at this level. Now we confused everything. In India, take the elections. From panchayat to parliament, in general, the public response is exactly identical. Have you noticed it? In general, there are of course a few local exceptions. Karnataka in 1985, after Indira Gandhi's death, parliament they voted for post Indira Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi, and once assembly was dissolved, they voted for Ramakrishna Hegde. This was about the only significant exception in the history of this country, when the people actually showed a difference between the parliament election and the state election. Otherwise, from panchayat to parliament, the people, the political parties, the government, everybody is thoroughly confused. Whereas it's not Narendra Modi's duty to make sure that your garbage is clear. And it's not a sarpanch's duty to make sure that the defense of India is safe. And we have got a thoroughly messed up political system. That is one thing we are not taking into account. I am not arguing, nobody can argue that at various stages there are no different duties. The second fallacy of this argument is that things are going well now in a centralized system. Can anybody honestly say this in this country? I remember on the 5th of February 1988, before any of you was born, I was a district magistrate and Rajiv Gandhi was the prime minister. He held a district magistrate's conference and I led a team of my 25 district magistrates and I made a presentation on this very subject incidentally. I was arguing for district governments. And I started off my presentation with the sentence I uttered here. I said, Mr. Prime Minister, a district in India is larger than half the nations of the world. The Prime Minister was actually very tired. It was evening. He already traveled many parts of the country that day. It was evening 7:30. So he came with the drooping eyelids. The moment I said it, suddenly his eyes widened and he was very, very responsive and very reactive. He made many, many arguments. I don't want to go into great detail. I told him, Mr. Prime Minister, remember two things. If they elect you, the people elect you as the Prime Minister, you extol the virtues of our people. You say how wonderful our democracy is, how great and brave and wise and wonderful the people of this country are. And you think the same people are utterly incapable of electing their municipal chairman or a sarpanch. So you have to figure out, either they are idiots in electing you as Prime Minister of India, or they are wise in electing their local leaders, at least as wise. You can't have two different standards for the same person. Of course, he had no answer. I told him another thing. I said, look, I challenge you, I actually use this expression, I challenge you, Mr. Prime Minister. You go to any part of this country, you can command your airplane and then go to any part of the country. Go to any public office, like I asked you today, go to any public office of your choice to get any public service that you need as a citizen, which you are entitled to. Not gratis. And only one condition I impose is, please go incognito, let them not know you are the Prime Minister of India. You, like in the old fashioned emperors and kings, you have heavy makeup or have a burqa, do whatever, but let them not know you are the Prime Minister. That's the only request I have. You see and you face what the people of India are facing every single day. Things have improved, but thanks to technology largely. Thanks to transparency that came out of technology. But if you take the governance system as such, the improvement related to what is possible is minuscule even today. That argument was much stronger than in 1988, but it's equally strong today. So things are pretty rotten. It cannot be our case that locally everything will work out wonderfully, not at all. But if it doesn't work out well, let the people pay the price. Let them know that my vote, my decision, my voice, it made a difference, good or bad. And I want to change it, make it better, let me do it differently. And once you have 100 flowers blooming, 1,000 flowers blooming, somebody somewhere will do something good. When you go on your good governance yatras, what do you find? You find some really promising initiatives. You go to another village, another town, another district in the same state, and you ask them, look, in so-and-so village this is happening, why is it not happening here? What is the response you get? Hey, whenever and again, this is different. As if this is a different species altogether. In the same district or in the same state. So what is the challenge of India? When somebody does something well somewhere, we are not even able to replicate that. Each one is a heroic exceptionalism rather than the norm in our institutional framework. Governance is about creating an institutional framework that makes it the norm. Not create a few exceptions and then garlanding them and then erecting their statues. This will begin to happen. If people are so dumb, they don't want to demand that despite somebody in the neighborhood village doing well, they deserve it. Let them suffer. Why are you worried? 30 years ago in one district, I did 200,000 acres of irrigation, lift irrigation, small irrigation, 453 lift irrigation schemes, 2,800 borewells, and a whole lot of other things, some 70 diversion schemes, 200,000 acres at a very low cost. I'll give you some numbers. In the whole state at the time of Andhra Pradesh, the erstwhile larger Andhra Pradesh, out of 22 districts outside of Hyderabad, in 20 years, the government could do only 110,000 acres. 22 districts, 20 years, 110,000 acres. One district, 2.5 years, 200,000 acres. The government's expenditure was in those days 15,000 rupees per acre on an average. My expenditure was 2,000 to 3,000 rupees per acre. Government gave it as 100% subsidy. In my case, I gave only 50% subsidy from government. The balance money was borrowed from banks, and every rupee, every pie was repaid much before the due date. Every rupee, every pie. For the schemes the government had done, the government was paying in perpetuity every year, in those days, 450 rupees an acre for maintenance. Here, zero maintenance. The people are maintaining themselves. In case of many borewells, government dug the borewells, they were successful, But electrification was not done. Those were the days when electricity was scarce, all kinds of problems, and of course you have some rules about how many poles, AO, capital cost. No, I don't want to go into details. Here every one of them was electrified and fully utilized. All this without a single extra input related to any other district or the state, without a single extra public servant added to the roles. It did not happen because of me. It happened when I was there. It happened because I gave the power to the people. I said, you decide whether you want the scheme or not, if the water is available, if it can be tapped, if it's technically feasible. If the cost is not too high, because we're still a poor country, we can't have an unlimited cost within a reasonable cost. And if you are willing to contribute 50%, you don't have money. Therefore, I will make sure that you get the loans. That part is my part, my job. The administrative part to make sure the documentation is there, land records, that's all, that's a job. But you have to borrow and you have to repay as an individual, not as a collective. And if you're willing for that, all I need from you to get the scheme sanctioned is, you show me 100 rupees per acre in the bank account, that you are committing yourself to this. If you can't afford 100, put 50 rupees per acre in the bank account. I need nothing else. The scheme stands sanctioned. Then I told them, you decide which of my 600 engineers in the district would execute this scheme. You figure out whom you trust most. Doesn't matter which department, as long as they are under my control in the state, in the district. Revenue, Panchayat Raj, or minor irrigation, medium irrigation, major irrigation, investigative wing, IDC, something else. No, you don't have to go into all the details. There were 600 fellows under my charge, all engineers. I told them, you decide whom you want. For whatever reason, it's your problem. If you choose the wrong fellow, it's your problem. And if there are any problems in execution, you tell me. It's my duty to sort it out. Otherwise, I have nothing to do with this. It's your life, your future. I refuse to inspect. The few villages I visited, I didn't go to monitor the schemes, because people en route, when they knew that I was traveling, they would stop me and say, sir, please come and see, we are doing such good work. And they were proud. They had to show me. And if it's already, there was nightfall, they used to have Petromax lights in those days. And because, after all, this is all in fields, there's no electrification there. So they used to take me there and show me. Things that took 20 years, 15 years, they happened in 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks. All of this is real. That's the kind of potential that exists in this country. I'm not saying everywhere you can do such fantastic work. The circumstances, the resource base, and the sector. It may be some other sector somewhere, but that's the kind of potential. 22 districts, 20 years, 110,000 acres, at an exorbitant cost. One district, 2.5 years, 200,000 acres, at 1/7 to 1/8 of the cost. Rest of it is detail. It could never have been done if the Prime Minister of India decided he would do it. Never if the Chief Minister decided. Never if I decided. People decided. My duty was to remove the fetters, the stupidity. And when some of the rules were utterly irrational, remove the wretched things. These are matters of detail. Or look at Kurian on a much grander scale. You all know about the dairy cooperatives in the country? The milk cooperatives? India, what is India's rank in milk production in the world? We are number one. Kurian did it. Kurian did it on a grand scale across the country. Not because some chief minister and prime minister decided, but because the people who actually produce milk, these humble milk producers owning one or two buffaloes or cows, they have the power to decide what they would do at each level. Or the chap called Bharati, I forget his full name, he's actually a DMK chap, I'm told. He was elected as a mayor of or municipal chairman of a small little town, Allandur. Anybody from Tamil Nadu? You have some idea of Allandur municipality, now part of Chennai city? It's now part of Chennai city, but at the time a separate municipality, an 80,000 population. You know what this Bharati did? I never even met him so far. He decided that building a proper sewerage network is an important requirement for the town, for a growing town. Typically in many small towns, even in big cities today, there is hardly any sewerage system. We pretend there is sewerage in India. In small towns there is no pretension also. So there will be septic tanks, because they are all badly managed and badly built, badly designed. It all overflows, goes into the local gutter, there will be smell, there will be mosquitoes. When the tank actually becomes full with the solid waste, because there is no other choice, then you keep hollering, and the municipal fellow comes with the old Marahua motor, he tries to pump it into a dirty tanker, and there will be smell all around. Then finally, with all that leaking, this tanker goes out of the town outskirts and then dumps it in the low-lying area somewhere. This is a typical management of sewerage in the country, or sewage in the country. And this man decided that they deserve something better. He inspired the community. He mobilized the community. He raised about 8 crore rupees from the people in a small town of 80,000 population. Because he was the first mover, he got loans from many agencies, etc. So a 35 crore rupee program was implemented well, because he's an honest guy. He wanted to deliver within 3 years' time. And you know what happened? The property values that stood initially at 1,000 rupees per square yard, they shot up to 10,000 rupees within 2 years. I mean, see the direct impact on your own purse, your own wealth, your own well-being. That is the right kind of incentive, that it makes a difference to me. I'm very fond of quoting one other example. Some of you may have read what I said or what I've written about it. One day I was traveling in California, Bay Area. I think I was going from east to west. I was traveling in this direction. So to my right-hand side is a city called Sunnyvale. Even now you can check up in the Bay Area of California. It's a very well-known place. To my left-hand, to the south, is Cupertino. So my Indian friends who were escorting me, they told me about these towns. Cupertino, I think, is where Google headquarters is located, if I'm not mistaken. I was not very familiar with the surroundings. They were just explaining to me. Then they told me, do you know some of the property values in Cupertino are about 50 to 70% higher than in Sunnyvale compared to this? I said, I don't see any difference. To the naked eye, it appears infrastructure is as good. There's no difference. The greenery, the infrastructure, the roads, everything appears to be the same. Is there a substantial difference in infrastructure that I cannot see? They said, no, sir. Identical infrastructure. Then I thought a little bit. I said, is there a significant mixed population here if African Americans, others are there? You know, immediately, because the prejudices, the property values plummet there. People don't want to move into these areas. Slums, ghetto, crime, or straightforward racial prejudice. They said, no, it's roughly the same kind of mix of population. Then I said, then why is there so much difference? They said, the school district in Cupertino, the board that manages the schools, which is a local one, by the way, it functions very well. Therefore, the schools in Cupertino are very good schools. Under American law, you can send your kids to a local public school, the government school, free of any tuition fee, because already you are paying taxes, only if you are the local taxpayer. Therefore, there is an in-migration. People want to be owners of property here and want to pay local taxes so that their kids can go to these good schools without paying an additional fee. See the way the system worked. The incentives are structured. And because there is, unlike our own Mumbai or some other place, they can't simply build as they please. There are some municipal rules and zoning laws and some town planning and adhere to strictly anywhere, whether Cupertino or Sunnyvale. Here the demand outstripped the supply, the value shot up. What a marvelous thing. Exactly what happened subsequently, at that time I was not aware of our Alandur. Exactly what happened in Alandur subsequently. You can cite 1,000 examples like that. It has a direct impact on your wealth, in your well-being, on your assets, and the quality of life you enjoy. That is local government, not some romantic notion, not some doctrinaire issue. Whatever works best, and design it in a manner that there is accountability. Hold it down. things can go wrong, believe me. In local elections, even more money is spent on elections in per capita terms, because you have smaller constituencies. Therefore, for elections, at least in the southern states and Maharashtra, etc., if an assembly constituency costs about 5 or 10 crores, a local panchayat costs sometimes 1 or 2 crores. There are cases where 3, 4 crores are spent on one panchayat election. So I have no illusions. The distortions of democracy will continue. But where is the incentive to improve? Where is it more likely to improve? And if messes up, where is it more likely that the people will learn it's their mistake, not somebody else's? They can't blame anybody else. It's theirs and theirs alone. And one last point before we open it to whatever other questions you may have. And it's not merely about local governments. It's not merely about municipalities, more municipalities in my view than panchayats, because in municipalities there is a feeling that I paid taxes, damn it, I'm not getting what I wanted in return. Therefore, there is a greater likelihood of people asserting. In panchayats, we killed the self-respect. We killed the sense of community. We made people mendicants. But municipalities is more likely to work, at least to start with. But that apart, it's about cooperatives that Kurian all his life fought for. It's about other forms of local organization, so that government at a higher level does not control what you do in your life. That you enjoy your liberty, collectively you do what you think is best for you. Autonomy of these forms of organization, as long as you don't violate a law, as long as you don't hurt other people. That's what democracy is. Cooperatives should be completely free. Government shouldn't control. And yet for 70 years, government controlled in this country. As Kurian always said, the cooperative registrar is the Brahma and the Vishnu and the Shiva, Lord Shiva. He creates, he sustains, he destroys the cooperatives. They have nothing to do with the people, which is a disaster. And that's why I fought long and hard to remove the government's control. The 97th Amendment to the Constitution of India is essentially about that. Very few people know about it, but in many ways I am the architect of that amendment. I insisted on Article 19(1)(c) being amended and including cooperatives in the protection of the fundamental rights along with unions and societies, societies and unions. 97th Amendment. Like everything else in India, the government did a stupid thing against my advice. They brought in a separate chapter on cooperatives in the Constitution, Chapter 9B. I told them, it's not necessary. The powers that be said, Dr. Jayaprakash, you want to transform India, we want to win elections. If you want to win elections, we have to show to people you have done something great. Therefore, we need a chapter, which is a silly idea. But they had the power, what can we do? That, of course, is struck down by Gujarat High Court. Now the matter is being fought in the Supreme Court. But that's an aside. But basically, it's not merely about elected local governments. There are other forms of local organization that should be, as far as practicable, independent of government control. Of course, there are areas where they should be controlled by government. Pollution, public order. If they do hurt other people's rights, do something terribly wrong for other people, certainly government should come in. But otherwise, you do your own thing. Your money, your life, you do your own thing. If possible, I'll help you. If not, I'll stay away. Step aside. That should be the approach of the government. Not being a Brahma and Vishnu and Shiva. That a citizen's life cannot be lived freely without government's interference. It's a nonsensical notion. So the notion of local governance is bigger and deeper than the 73rd, 74th Amendments. Okay? Because we lost some time, we had to hurry through some of these things. I would have love to have a much more interactive thing so that we can discover this together, but time sometimes is a tyrant. So whatever time is available now, 20 minutes is yours.
We'll take questions through CAN. We already have posted your questions, right? So we'll take questions specific to the topic today, and Dr. JP has been gracious to say that he'll come back in the evening if he has time, and then we can open it up for questions outside decentralization, local governments. We have many other questions on that.
Around so, 6 o'clock, I'll be back. I'm going to Ashoka University. So I am at your disposal, because tonight I can't anyway take the flight after a 2-hour Delhi in the evening, and then going at midnight doesn't make any sense. So I'm staying for the night until you're exhausted or I'm exhausted. Okay.
Right. Sure. The first question, Love Pratik Singh.
Hello. Great ideas, sir, on decentralization. But don't you think the legislative changes required for implementing them will come only through the parliament, and most of the parliamentarians, as we see them now, have a vision which don't seem to be in the direction of decentralization, and some of them may be having some vested interest in status quo. So
you're absolutely right. I have fought long and hard to get the 73rd amendment further amended. I tried my absolute best, but I failed. Probably nobody tried harder and better in the past 20 years. I don't have a realistic expectation it will happen through a constitutional change, though that's the ideal thing. If the constitution is restructured and we guarantee that there are local governments, self-governing local governments, and the power has to be transferred to the third tier, but the detail is left to the states, that is the best model. We did the exact opposite. We created overstructured and underpowered local governments. As I keep telling people, the American Constitution, when it was promulgated, had 4,700 words. Today, with all the amendments, it has about 7,400 words. The 73rd, 74th amendments alone, they run into 7,700 words. It's longer than the American Constitution today, almost double the original American Constitution. But we created a disgraceful system. But I don't have realistic hope of that being changed. I fought very hard, but now I know it's no longer possible. Forget it. Therefore, what else can we do? There are some approaches. For instance, the Constitution, with all its flaws, does talk about the ward and wards committees, the sub-local governments in the municipal areas. Supposing we, wherever possible, use that as a lever and empower the community rather than merely an elected municipal council and mayor alone. Supposing we transfer more resources to local governments as part of the larger federal transfer. That's why I fought with the 14th Finance Commission a great deal to see that a significant part of the transfer of resources from Delhi to states goes to local governments. It's better than what it was, as I mentioned to you, the numbers 285,000 crores are thereabout in 5 years. But it's nothing compared to what ought to be. Out of 39,000 crores, what we all achieved was 7%. Where I told them, at least 25-30%, make it a percentage, don't give an absolute number. So that in future, that becomes the benchmark. And we can try and improve. And as the overall allocation improves, this also improves. And if money goes, even if there's a structural problem, powers automatically flow. So they'll figure out, the equilibrium will come. But sadly, I knew the Finance Commission chairman and members very well, very close personal friends, many of them, and worked with them for a long time. I have respect and admiration. They did a good job in my view on the whole, but this was a terrible, terrible blunder. A priceless opportunity was squandered. But even now, we must move in that direction. Can we, by a constitutional devolution, see that a fixed proportion of, let's say, 25-30% of the money that goes from Delhi to states actually goes to local governments? It's not a loss of money to anybody. That means automatically those functions also state doesn't have to do. Now the local government will do. It's just that who will do it rather than how much money goes. Money will be the same money. Money will not be less. But we don't have the wisdom because, as you said rightly, the MLAs and the officers are the greatest enemies of local governments. We all know how to develop best interest for no good reason. We all want to feel that we are in power, we are in control, apart from corruption, etc. It's also a mindset issue.
Shantanu?
Sure.
Yeah.
And after that, go on.
Okay, so we, a couple of years ago, we saw the disbanding of the Planning Commission and the setup of the Niti Aayog as an attempt to decentralize planning at the central level itself. What's your take on that, and what did you say has been, I mean, give the Niti Aayog, from whatever I've read, has not been very successful at its role. So what do you see as the future of decentralized planning then?
No, to the extent that instead of the Planning Commission, which arrogated to itself the power to decide which state will get what, power to summon chief ministers and summon officials for every small little thing, that is replaced by a more humble organization, and where allocation of resources to states is now not dependent on somebody's largesse or discretion, but it is a constitutional matter as a matter of right and more transparent, it's a welcome step. But I think Niti Aayog still has to figure out what is its role, how it will perform. Let us wait and see. But to that extent, definitely it's a step forward, and I think we all should welcome it irrespective of political parties.
Akash Singh.
Can we use the mic, Akash?
Your vision of decentralization is very similar to Arvind Kejriwal's vision of decentralization. Can you comment over that?
I am delighted if, to the extent that Arvind shares this vision and implements it because he has now an opportunity in Delhi, I will be delighted. But the problem with power is decentralization up to me, centralization up to me. So we must actually make it happen. I am sure Arvind is doing better than many governments in the country. I don't know enough about it, but I really want it to happen in full measure, but with accountability, without romanticism, with accountability, with checks and balances.
Okay. Mahesh, Gondi Mahesh.
How do you view about Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana scheme, and how to replicate the Adarsh the models mentioned in that scheme? And one more question, like does the gram panchayats or the local governments require the legislative powers and the subjects transferred to them?
First question first. And something good is happening somewhere to make it as a model, to propagate that knowledge and spread the best practices is a good thing. It is obviously mankind prospers and improves through imitation. Man is the only species that is capable of the best imitation. Anybody who raises children understands that. Without the capacity for imitation, mankind would be like other animals. We are also an animal, but we are not like other animals. Each generation is better than earlier generations because we imitate. We learn from the best. To that extent, it's valuable. But to the extent it's a patronizing exercise, talking about a few models here and there, outliers, rather than institutionalized mechanism to bring the best leadership and propagate the best practices, I think it is a very perfunctory and symbolic exercise. You hear me? If you really give a chance, many of you sitting here and many out there, millions upon millions of this country, are willing to do whatever it takes to improve the conditions locally. In the last election, even in a richer state like Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, at the time a single state, I've seen some very bright people getting elected. I've seen an IITian whose class fellows were senior executives in Microsoft or Google, etc., etc., very well-educated man, going and becoming a sarpanch of a village. I've seen an ex-Navy chap, I think. He became a sarpanch of a village in Kakumanu, and he was actually trying to mobilize the people, and 19 panchayats united and tried to reduce corruption, at least for the time being. A lot of people coming with inspiration. But we made it so hard for them to survive, to make a meaningful difference, because we made these very hollow offices, inconsequential offices. When you come in, there's a lot of energy, there's a lot of dynamism, there's a lot of idealism. And in a few months' time, we badger them and we simply hammer them into submission. Either they become cynical, or they become part of a corrupt institutional framework, or they're beaten to a pulp and therefore ultimately they retire with deep disappointment in life. So we must believe that leadership exists. You are an example. Our duty, the system's duty, is to encourage that and allow it to reach the top, whatever be the level. Top is not the Prime Minister of India. Bratton, for instance, a police chief with Giuliani, by the way, in those days in New York, is a global name. He is now Los Angeles Police Commissioner, if I'm not mistaken. Giuliani is a global name. These people exist. You have a system where the best are allowed to rise to the top and make a difference and have a satisfactory life, a sense of fulfillment. You have another system where nobody is allowed to do anything unless you are the Prime Minister and Chief Minister. Even then, you hardly bring about a big change except you have many statues and many names. You have to figure out. There are millions of Indians who can make a significant difference locally. This is natural. Our society is not bereft of talent or leadership. We are killing it. We are destroying it. We made it perfunctory. The second part, now I forget the question.
Does the local governments require legislative powers on the subject transfer?
Yes, no. The word legislation, we don't have to worry too much about semantics. If, for instance, a traffic regulation, local government has authority, they make a regulation, that's legislation for your purpose. So let's not worry about the semantics of it. Similarly, if a local government says, this is the zoning, this is where the hawkers will be, this is where some, that's a legislation. So local government, to the extent that they perform their functions, must have the authority to frame the local guidelines and the regulations and the power to enforce it. And therefore, I'm a great supporter of local courts being kept under local government, not under local government, but working together, but local policing kept under local government for limited functions, details in whatever I have written, it exists, you can check the internet, etc. But without going into too many details, as many as possible, whatever the basic principle is, the German principle, what they call subsidiarity. What it says is, you give to the local government as much as that can be done. If you give to a larger tier, the question must be, why have you given it, not why not have you given it. That is, only what cannot be done locally must be transferred to a larger tier. And only what cannot be done by this district or state thing can go to the much larger one, not the other way around. In other words, in this scheme, the citizen and his family are the center of the universe. Then a community of stakeholders. It may be the local mohalla. It may be a school. It may be some other organization which they have common stakes, collective stakes, if they are clearly defined. Then a local government. Various tiers of local government. Then the state. Then the national government. And as far as practicable, the citizen and family must be empowered. Only those that citizen and family cannot do on their own, either for reasons of economy of scale or convenience or managerial capability, should that be transferred to this. That's why we don't decide what the child in the family should study. We only say, you must study at least X number of years. No state ever says, this child must only study this. Because none of our business. It's for the family to decide which course, what to do with their lives, or whom you marry. It's none of our business. It's the family that should decide. As long as there are certain norms, you can't marry off below a certain age, you can't forcibly marry them off. Though, of course, they're doing it all with impunity in this country. But otherwise, it's individual decision. But there are things which the family cannot handle. The local school, even if you're a Tata, you can't handle the local school. Or some other institution which have stakes. It has to go to stakeholders group as far as practicable. They can't handle a road because who is a stakeholder in a road? It has to go to a local government. They can't handle, obviously, the big projects, larger things, larger taxation issues. It has to go to the state. They can't handle national defense or currency, etc. It has to go to the nation. So the principle is, why are you delegating it to a larger tier, not a higher tier? Is larger or smaller? To me, in my mind, only for common purposes, I'm using the word central occasionally, central government. I hate the word central government because people don't understand any other language I'm using it. To me, there's only union government. Nowhere in the constitution does it say central government. It's a federal government. The center has to be the citizen and the community of stakeholders. It has to be a principle of subsidiarity. I am not saying everything will be organized in that manner overnight, but let's have the basic principle in place with the reasoning. Then we can figure out how best we can adapt and adopt. Yes.
Sir, my name is
Anand. That's the last question.
I have been closely following you since last 15 years. In fact, I was a great fan of your writings in E-Nadu. Then I was working with your you in Lok Satta as an NGO. You mentioned about a great deal of local bodies, sir. I belong to the same district where you have revolutionized the irrigation experiments, Prakasham district. In the same Prakasham district, as you know, it is one of the poorest districts once, is one of the costly election doing districts as of now. In my village, where there are about 1200 voters, the panchayat election is costing roughly around 30 to 35 lakhs.
Which village is that?
Singanapalam, Mandalamur Mandalam, Darsi constituency.
Okay.
So I started inquiring about why so much of money is getting poured. I came to know that in 1 year, roughly around 1.1 crore rupees got dumped into that village in the name of Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme.
Yes.
And I started investigating, like, where did this money gone? Not even a single work of productivity was been done. And you know about what has been happening in Hyderabad corporation elections. Each corporate has spent about more than 4 rupees. So if it is so systematic about local bodies will be a remedy for all the problems at the capacity of the personality you have been mentioning. And you said that you have fought the best of your capacities in terms of local bodies. My question is about, was there any proposal, systematic proposal submitted to the union government in terms of how to eradicate the lapses of such kind of, you know, local mammoth corruption that is being happening?
Thank you. I couldn't get your name.
So my name is Brahmaya. You can call me Brahmam.
Okay, Dharma.
Brahmam.
Very precise and detailed proposals have been furnished. It's all available in the net also. I will not go into details, but it is not my argument that local government is a panacea. I want it to be clear. From the beginning, I repeatedly mentioned, I have no romantic notion. I know the fellows here are the same scoundrels that the fellows there. No, it's not a different stock. Just because you're local, you don't become something different. It's not a different species. If you notice, the tenor of what I've been trying to discuss is, how do you create a different incentive structure to get the better behavior and outcomes? A citizen, elected fellow, a bureaucrat, and somebody else. It is not a guarantor that things will automatically improve. At the end of the day, there has to be accountability. At the end of the day, citizens must be aware of their self-interest. If that Mandalamur Mandal, that village fellows, the 1500 fellows, are not aware of the 1 crore 10 lakh rupees coming to their village, they were content with the 1000 rupees or 2000 rupees they got for the vote, if they're idiots, there's nothing much we can do. And anyway, irrespective of local governments or state governments, it's happening anyway. My argument is twofold. If it's a local government, you can go and tell them, I can go and tell them, look, it's your 1 crore 10 lakh rupees. That comes to about 6,600 rupees per head, per year. And you idiot sold your vote for 1,000 rupees. In 5 years, it's 30,000 rupees per head. And of 1,500 people, maybe only 700 are voters, or 750. Of them, only 650 voted. So in effect, if you take actually the voter strength, voting population, you lost about a lakh of rupees in 5 years' time. You sold the damned vote for 1,000 rupees. Are you not idiots? At least you and I can tell them. It's something that they can feel because it's their money, 1 crore 10 lakh rupees in their village. There is a chance that they will wake up. Two, in any case, I don't put my hopes on that. I'm not a romantic, as I said. I have argued then and I've been arguing now. You have a strong ombudsman at the district level, each district and each big city, with all the authority. Whatever you're talking about, Lokpal, etc., etc., it's not a Lokpal in Delhi that matters. It's the local ombudsman and the state level ombudsman's institutions. They matter much more. And give that institution substantial powers. Choose them wisely. Give them powers to sack these fellows who are elected with 30, 40 lakh rupees. Give them the power to confiscate their properties. Give them the power to prosecute. Give them the power to sack employees of government. Legal. So that there is a fear, there is a check, because things have gone too far. If in 1952 we were designing this, all these draconian powers are not required. Because the better impulses in society prevailed. The better class of people were willing to go into public life. The people had a sense of the collective and self-reliance. They were not made mendicants. They were not yet aware of the vote being bought. They thought of political office as an act of sacrifice. We don't want, there's no time to go into details. Maybe in the evening, if there's time, we'll discuss all these things. Each of these, there's a structural reason why things happen the way they happen. But things have come this far. Therefore, There is no panacea. While you improve institutions and alter incentives, you also have danda. You have local ombudsman, powerful local ombudsman. When I made this argument to Dr. Manmohan Singh, you know, Jammu and Kashmir in the year 2006 or 7, there were local elections. I don't recall the year, which year it was exactly. Do you all remember? 78% people voted in a state where in general elections 10-15% people only vote in large parts. I told the Prime Minister, it's a fantastic opportunity. It's a terrific vote of confidence in India. Now, this is an opportunity. He said, what shall I do? I told him what I keep telling people, what I told 14th Finance Commission later. You give per capita 1,000 rupees to every village and every municipality of Kashmir. And you transfer it as close to people as possible, not even to municipality, maybe a ward committee, maybe something else. You tell them, look, the following things are your things. It's your money, it's your problem. You sort out. Once the people are busy with their road, their drain, their garbage disposal, their sewerage, their local traffic, etc., their school, they'll forget all about India and Pakistan. That is the greatest guarantor of national security. Forget everything else. And if Kashmir, you can show that this works, then rest of India at least can follow. At least in case of Kashmir, you can make an exception because there's a national security issue. How to somehow embrace the people? How to give them a stake? How to make them feel that this is theirs? Because that is a challenge in Kashmir. And the Prime Minister, good man, a good friend, he said, you know, it was such great difficulty, we could persuade Jammu and Kashmir government to hold local elections. Now, I said, Prime Minister, you don't have to ask the state to give money. Kashmir has only 70-80 lakh population. With your left hand, you can sign that check. All you have to do is 80 lakh population, 1,000 rupees per year, 800 crores. You can just sign it with your left hand. The government of India, for a national security reason. You're spending a lot more money for so many unworthy causes. He was still demurring. I was egging him on. If I remember, the date was April 27, 2011. Yeah, 2011, now I remember. If I remember, the date was probably 2011, not 2007. It was a mistake. And in order to go even further, I said, if you're worried that the money may go to terrorist hands or something, Mr. Prime Minister, you please appoint local ombudsman. You find the finest officials of unimpeachable integrity, give them all the powers, create a legal framework, because the money you are giving from Government of India, you create a framework, administrative or legal, you say that you fellow have the complete authority. You know what the Prime Minister said? Suddenly he caught on to this. He said, but where will we find such good ombudsman, Jayaprakash? I mean, you're finding excuses. Instead of finding solutions to problems, you're finding problems to solutions. You must figure out. Do you have a better approach? 2-3 years later, Rahul Gandhi then goes and says, Panchayat should have been empowered. They were not empowered. Some of the sarpanches were beaten up and killed, and they went on a protest. That's too late. Stupidity. So I'm not saying that just because you institutionalize this locally, things will be fantastic. Democracy is a messy system. It's an inefficient system. It's inherently volatile system. But we have chosen it. Therefore, how do you now alter incentives to make the people behave differently? In voting, in paying taxes, in shouting in a responsible way, in collectively asserting themselves, in delivering, in enforcing accountability. How do you make it better? How do you alter incentives? There is no better method. But as I said, with responsibility, with institutional design in a manner that there's a minimum abuse of office. Or else, pray tell me, which yajna or which yaga I should perform to improve India within democratic framework. Unless you're telling me you become a leku on you, you will suddenly change everything. Even then it will not work. You will give an order from Delhi and everybody will follow. If they don't follow, you will shoot them down. You tell me that. At least theoretically, I'll consider that. If that's not the case, pray tell me what is the answer to Kashmir, to Telangana, to Andhra, to Maharashtra, to Marathwada, to Gujarat, to Bihar. Tell me what is the answer. Tell me how else and where else have things improved without local initiative. Show anything really grand and enduring in this country, it is because of local initiative, with or without institutional strength. Because a towering personality, a moral authority of an Anna Hazare, or the lifetime sacrifice of somebody, but is that the way to change a country? You want to improve one village, you want a lifetime sacrifice for that one village for moderate improvement? It didn't become America or Britain or Germany. For just moderate improvement, And Anna Hazare giving up his family life, working for 30, 40 years, only Ralagam Siddhi can't even get the sarpanch elected there, as you know. People don't even listen to him on that issue. Is that a viable model? Can you find a million Indians who will be Mahatma Gandhis, give up everything, willing to be killed, and say, I will improve my village and moderately improve in the next 30 years? Is that a viable model? Will that happen? Are you waiting for 10,000 years for India's improvement? Or are you institutionalizing some designs which are sensible, which alter the incentives, this is the key expression, alter the incentives of all the players, from the voter and taxpayer to the fellow sitting there on our behalf as our servant, in a responsible way, with accountability mechanisms institutionalized. It's not rocket science. It's practical wisdom. It's very hard for us to internalize because in India we have tremendous asymmetry of power. Let me conclude with this. 90% of Indian people are weaker and poorer and less empowered than an ordinary clerk in a tehsil office or ordinary police constable. There is no other democracy like this. Serious functioning democracy, I mean. We have chosen this. It's an audacious experiment. It's a revolutionary experiment that 90% illiterate, weak, poor, uninformed people, supposedly the masters and the voters and the taxpayers, and it is a small crust of very powerful, all-powerful, much more influential, much more empowered public servants. Allegedly public servants who actually are masters. This is a terrible asymmetry. Unless we bring back some degree of symmetry in this, there cannot be accountability, there cannot be service to the people. A teacher in a village school today is paid 50,000 rupees to 100,000 rupees in many cases. You know that? They should be paid even more. What is the outcome? What is the outcome? Is that the kind of country we want? You look at any sector, our people are shortchanged, underserved. We are pretending that we are doing well. And every other day we hear about our $2 trillion economy doing much better than the $10 trillion economy of China. And that our 7.9% or 7.6% is better than their 7.2%. The 1,000, 72% is 72 rupees. A 100, 7.2% is 72 rupees. A 100, 7.9% is 7.90 rupees. Every day we are arguing that our 7.90 rupees is higher than the 72 rupees of China. We cannot hoodwink ourselves. You want to change? Make Indians partners in this enterprise, their lives you are dealing with. They mess up, let them do so. If you love them, create the designs in a manner that the mess up is minimal, benefit is maximum. If you don't even know how to do that, let them suffer the consequences. For heaven's sake, get out of their lives. It's a tough message. For us English speaking people who have a pan-Indian vision, who think the Prime Minister is everything, Government of India is the be all and end all, but I think we must look at life as what it is, the reality of life, the things that matter to us in our household day-to-day basis from morning to night. And I appeal to you all because you're already committed to a cause larger than yourselves. And if you don't remove these cobwebs of the mind, go into the same old mindsets, 70 years we have done it. You have seen what happened. We have to learn lessons from the past, our own experience, experience of others, and innovate. I wish you all the very best. And evening, if you are inclined, I'll certainly spend some time. We can discuss this or any other issue of your choice, maybe around 6 o'clock. I wish you all the best.